Okay, so welcome back. This is part two in our series on understanding switching mode power supplies. And we're using this ATX 460 watt power supply as an example. And we're going to figure out all these different components and functions. What do they do and why are they there? And we're going to do some simulations in LTSpice to develop a simplified version of this. And in this part two, we're going to look at the front end. Now, in part one, we looked at basically the rectification circuit, which is this component right here. It's a full bridge rectifier. And we did a very simple LTSpice simulation to show you how to. This is basically the heart of the switch mode power supply, the converter that converts from AC to DC. But now we're going to get into a little bit more detail. And in this video, we're going to look at this, what I call the front end, which is the input filter and protection stage. And specifically, we're going to look at the protection part of this power supply. And we're going to venture outside the electronics world, and we're going to look at what's behind the wall outlet, where in the US you get your 120 volts, 60 hertz. What's on the power company side? What can we expect from the power company? What do they have so that we know how better to design our system, what components we need? So we're going to venture out into the power company world and see what they've got. And we're actually going to simulate the power company. Here's a simple LTSpice simulation of the power company. And we're going to look at what stuff they consider. And we're going to learn a bit about how you protect your equipment based on what they do. So first thing we're going to do is we're going to, you know, walk outside your house, your business, and look at the wires coming into your house, for example, and follow them down the street, and you will probably come up with a pole that looks a bit like this. And this is a power company pole where they take some very high voltage wires and they add a transformer to get it down to low voltages to feed to your house. And here's a very good example of one where they are taking, generally you'll see high voltages being transmitted on these poles by maybe two, three, or four wires on the very top of the pole. And these are very high voltages, generally in the 12,000 volt range, depending on where you are. It might be less, might be more, but just generally it's around 12,000 volts. And you might see two wires, which indicates a single phase of that 12,000 volts, which is only 12,000 divided by square root of 3, which is 7,200 volts, which is what this is. Or you might see three wires, which are 12,000 volts between wires. And you might see four wires where you've got a ground included. But in this case, we have a very simple single phase connection. And you, if you follow this wire down here, this is a 7,200 volt wire that comes in here and goes to this device that we'll talk about. Comes out of this device and goes into this tank here. And you can see there's also a connection from this connector here that goes to this other device. And this tank is basically a single phase transformer. And it takes 7,200 volts on the primary, and these are the two connectors to the primary, and converts it to 120 volts RMS, slash 240 volts. So you can see this is secondary, and I've got three terminals here for the secondary of this transformer. And they are 120 between each of the outside to this middle, and the middle is a ground or a neutral. And so if I measure between here and here, I see 120. If I measure between here and here, I see 120. And if I measure between the two outsides, I get 240. So this is very useful. I can get either 120 or 240 depending on what I need in the house. These three wires come out of the transformer and then run along between poles. These wires are stretched between the poles and then they tap off to your house and you get three wires coming in with 120 between the outside and the center, and then 240 across the two outsides. So that's basically what we've got here, probably very similar to what you will see. So what are these other devices? Well, as I said, we've got 7,000 volts coming in through here, and you can see on this tank, I've got this device here and this device here. These are basically called bushings, and they just provide an insulated connector so that I can take a very high 7,000 volts and connect it into this transformer inside this tank without connecting to the grounded tank or this grounded neutral, because then you'd have a short circuit. So it basically, you've got an energized conductor going right down the middle of this, and then on the outside you've got these what are called skirts, which give you an additional distance between this energized conductor and the ground. So it gives you insulation between the energized conductor and ground. And this other bushing connects down to neutral and ground, so you can have 7,200 to ground on the primary. And we're gonna do a little simulation to show you some details of this, but this is basically what you can expect. Now, as it comes in from the high voltage, what is this device here? Well, this right here, this long tube, is a fuse. And the purpose of this fuse is to protect this transformer. If something happens inside this transformer, you will get an increase in current. You might get a short circuit inside here, which means you're bypassing the load and you're having a low impedance across some terminals. You get a very high current and this fuse will blow. And if this fuse blows, what will happen is it will, or hopefully it will blow internally and open the connection, and then this will swing down and provide a visual indication for the line crews to say, hey, that fuse is blown, and they know to replace it, and also, more importantly, figure out why it blew in the first place, because fuses generally don't blow just because they want to. And you've got a little hook here you can grab with a long device, insulated device, you can manually open this. And this right here is just an insulator. Again, this is a grounded connector that connects to the pole. So you need some insulation between the 7,000 volts to ground. So that's all this is. These are little insulators. So as it comes out of the fuse, it goes into the bushing of this tank. And you can see it also taps off to this other device. What is this other device? Well, this is what's called a metal oxide varistor. It's also called a surge protector or a lightning arrestor, right? The purpose of this is to protect against very high voltages coming in off these wires, protect against having them go into the transformer and even into the secondary and damage stuff, okay? So you are protecting against very high voltages and high surges. The purpose of this is to see this high voltage and shunt that high current to ground so it doesn't pass into the transformer. So again, we've got a fuse and we've got a metal oxide varistor as a lightning protection. So let's take a little bit closer look at what this is. Again, this is a metal oxide varistor or a lightning arrestor, and it's rated for about 7,000 volts continuous, which makes sense because this is a 7,000 volt primary, and it will clamp around 24,000 volts. So if you get a pulse greater than 24,000 volts, this will clamp it. And again, we'll do a little simulation to see how that works and what it's all about. It can withstand 10,000 amps, and that is what's called an 8x20 microsecond pulse. And all that means is that they are standardizing what this lightning will look like, because lightning can be just about anything, right? A lightning pulse can get generated on these wires and come into it, but who knows what the lightning is going to look like? It could be a million volts, it could be tens of thousands of volts. So there's a standard that says, well, let's make it look like an 8x20 microsecond pulse, which means it takes 8 microseconds to rise to its maximum value, and it takes 20 microseconds after that to decay to zero. So it's basically a 30 microsecond wide pulse that might come into this transformer. And also, when you're talking about these high voltages and high currents, you have to figure out how much energy can this withstand. And this can withstand 20,000 joules. And a joule is a watt second, watts times second, kind of like kilowatt hours on your power company meter, basically a measure of how much energy this can withstand. So we'll talk about that, but again, this is basically a metal oxide varistor whose goal is to clamp any high voltages like from lightning or other types of surges. Okay, so now we are in LTSPICE and I've put together a very simplified version of what we looked at with the transformer on the pole and the protection and how it feeds your house and, you know, our basic rectifier, what that looks like. We're trying to give an overview. Again, this is very generalized. It's not specific. It's going to vary a lot at your location, but at least it will give you a conceptual idea of how things are wired and what to expect. So here's the circuit. Over on the right is my result from part one, where we put together a simple bridge rectifier. And on the far left is the source from the power company coming into that power pole. And I've simulated a simple 7200 kV AC 60 hertz source right here. And of course, that's a peak of 10,200. 7200 times square root of 2. And here's our basic single phase voltage source. Now I'm also going to simulate a lightning pulse. That's what this pulse source is. So we're going to add those together. We'll talk about that in a bit. But and then we've got, I just threw some numbers in for inductance and capacitance of the line feeding up from the substation to this transformer. Again, these are just numbers I throw in that are pretty much meaningless. And then, as we recall from this actual installation, we've got a fuse and we've got a metal oxide varistor at the input to this transformer. So I didn't model a fuse. You can imagine there's a fuse in here somewhere. Here's the metal oxide varistor. I didn't connect it because I don't have a model of a 24 kV arrestor, but it's not going to matter too much to our purposes. Again, 24 kV clamping for this particular one. And then here in this box is our transformer. It's basically this guy right here. And I've got 7,200 volts coming in, phase to ground. And here's the primary. And you can see the secondary is a center tapped winding. And I've just put in some inductance values to give me the correct ratio from 7,200 to 120 on both. And I've got my center tap, I've got it grounded like the power company has, and that is also the neutral. And on either side, I've got these coming out of the transformer. I've got 120 here, 120 here, and our grounded neutral. So this comes out of the tank and it goes, it stretches, you know, for hundreds, thousands of feet, mile, whatever it is, between poles until it gets to your house. And in the meanwhile, there are many taps off to other customers in your neighborhood, right? So at some point it gets to your house and it comes from the pole outside your house and it stretches over to the wall of your house, to what's called the weatherhead. And it's connected there and then it drops down into the meter, the kilowatt hour meter, where they measure your energy usage. And then it goes into this main panel. Probably in the basement somewhere or somewhere in your house, the main panel. And it's basically allows you to tap off two different outlets and provide protection, circuit breakers, and that kind of thing. We're not going to model that, but just know that it's there. And then we're modeling here the line to neutral, the two-wire connection going to our power supply. So this is kind of the basic configuration you can expect. Again, this is a very simplified model. I don't have saturation. I don't have this modeled exactly. It's just a generalized ideal model of a transformer, just so we can see. So what I'm going to do is I am going to simulate this voltage, and I'm also adding a pulse in here. And we said we're going to use an 8x20 microsecond pulse. And I'm starting out initial voltage of 0, and on. I just picked 20,000 volts peak just because we're going to pick different ones. Again, nobody knows what the lightning's going to look like. The delay, I just picked 20 milliseconds, so it would be on our plot. And then the rise time, 8 microseconds. Fall time, 20 microseconds, and it's on for 1 microsecond. Okay, so that's what we're simulating for a pulse coming into the transformer. So if I run this, you can see here is the voltage at this primary, basically right at this point right here on the transformer. If I have my regular voltage, 7 kV coming from the power company, plus I've included a 20 kV lightning pulse. And again, this is just a very generalized, it may be nothing like reality, but it's just to give you a visual picture. So I'm going up to 10 kV peak, but this pulse is going to give us maybe 35 kV total in the voltage coming into this primary. And if I zoom in on this, you can see, again, this is not going to be accurate. It depends on the capacitance, the inductance, and much other things. But you can see I'm going to get a pulse that might go up 30 kV. And we said that this MOV will clamp at 24 kV. So if we had this modeled, you'd probably see it flatten out here below 25 kV. But anyway, just to give you a visual, so you might expect a pulse like that coming into the primary. So if something gets through, let's take a look, let's knock this out, and let's take a look at one of the 120 volt lines on the secondary that might come to your house. And again, let's zoom that out, and we might see a peak very similar to the primary, but now we're down. Here's our 170 volts peak. We might get 350 volts here. So the point of this is that you may see on the secondary, at your main panel coming in from the power company, you may see high voltage peaks from lightning, or there's a bunch of other things that can cause these peaks. Lightning is generally the worst because it's the highest voltage, but others can last longer. So that's why you need to have some sort of protection on the input of your power supply. And we're going to see that we're going to need something like this MOV, and we're going to see what that looks like. But now keep in mind, just because you get a high voltage peak coming into the transformer doesn't mean you'll see it at any particular point in your residence, your business. Because, it might flash over to ground some point. It might not make it out of the transformer. It might flash over on the wires going to your neighbor. So, it's really it's a coin toss to figure out what's actually going to come into your house, if anything. Depends on, the location of the lightning strike. And it's really, really, it's an entire science project to figure it out. But at least you can get an idea of why we're worrying about input protection. So what we're going to do, I have added to the input of this simple bridge rectifier. We've got the 120 volts coming in. I've added an MOV. And this is, I just happened to be able to get a hold of a Born's 20D 241K that's kind of sort of close to what we might need. It's rated 200 volts DC. It clamps at around 395 volts, and it can withstand 108 joules, all right? So, this can only withstand a certain amount of heat and energy before it's going to blow up. So the answer is 108 joules. So the reason why we're only seeing on this secondary, measured across this MOV, why we're only seeing 350 is probably because this is in service, and it's rated, it's clamping at up to 395 volts. So it probably clamped something. So how do we know if this thing operated, if it clamped? Well, let's check the current here. And let's get rid of this line voltage. And you can see that normally the current through this MOV was zero. But when the spike came through, we got a peak of 36 amps for, you know, the 30 microseconds or whatever the pulse lasted. So it did its job. It clamped and it shunted a bunch of current, in this case, only about 36 amps, but it shunted that to ground. So the question is, did it damage the MOV? Did we pick the right MOV? Well, this can withstand 108 joules. So how do we find out what this can withstand? So if you hover over this and you hit the Alt key, it will tell you how many watts are dissipated. So let's get rid of this current. And here is the watts. Let's zoom out so we get the watts dissipated in that MOV. So it comes up to, wow, we were up to 13,500 kilowatts for, what is it, 30 microseconds, okay? So here is the watts dissipated by this MOV. A lot of watts, but for a very short amount of time. So what I can do is I can figure out how many joules or watt seconds were dissipated in this. And by doing to do that, I go control, left click, and you can see that LTSpice gives us the average is 463 watts, which doesn't help us, but it takes an integral and tells you how many joules are represented by this amount of energy, and it's 45 millijoules. So no problem whatsoever. It's good for 108 joules, but it only expanded 45 millijoules. Okay, I think that's about it for this video. In the next part, part three, we're going to get into some details on metal oxide varistors. What are they? How do they work? They're extremely important devices. They're used all over the power system. They're used in electronic equipment. So it's really important to understand them. And then after that, we're going to start getting into power factor correction. We talked about some of the things that can come in from the power company, some surges that we need to protect against, but we also need to consider what things we send out to the power company and to the other customers. So that comes into the power factor correction. So hope that helps. Take care and have a really good day. Thanks.